April 1982. The footmen are changing guard at Schloss Regensburg in Bavaria. This palace used to be a monastery. Then, 200 years ago, the princes of Thurn and Taxis made it their home. And today, its cloisters form a fitting backdrop for a solemn family occasion. Prince Karl August von Thurn und Taxis was born in 1898, when the aristocracy still lauded it in the Kaiser's Germany. Their courts and ceremonials were swept away by the First World War, but in Schloss Regensburg, the old rituals of nobility linger on. Karl August was the 10th prince of Thurn und Taxis, and now the 11th prince is his son Johannes, who, with his wife, the Princess Gloria, is raising a new generation of the family, in a country where princes and princesses do not officially exist. Aristocrats like to feel their continuing family identity can transcend the inconveniences of life and even death. Respect for ancestors is one expression of this, and the reverence flows strong in Prince Johannes.
I think most of the people who knew my father realized that he was a very dedicated person. He was the person who would go out of his way to please other people. He was a sort of saint, and I believe most of the people did realize that he was a great personality, and he took his duty to help others very serious. And I think that's what many people wanted to demonstrate when they came.
The lying in state of Prince Karl August was extended by 2 days to make time for all the mourners who wished to pay their final respects. And among the family mourners was his daughter-in-law, the Princess Gloria, born a countess of German and Hungarian descent.
I knew my father-in-law quite well, and he really became a very, very close friend of mine. When my husband went away for business trips, I used to stay a lot with him, and I thought he was a very interesting man. He spoke 12 languages perfect, and I had a conversation with him in Hungarian always, so he appreciated that very much. And I was together with him a lot, and he was my friend more than my father.
Wir sind bereits beim Forte. Ihr müsst ganz zurückbleiben. Nicht? Bitte nochmal, ja.
Schloss Regensburg is preparing to bid its prince farewell in style. All the rituals of aristocracy are moments of theatre. And on the day before this exit, the stage is being set with special care.
Thank you.
In a world of increasing informality, Schloss Regensburg remains one bastion of etiquette. Mourning will now be worn by the family for 6 full months, but the Princess Maria Theresia is exempt. She's not yet 2. The protocol goes back to the Spanish court ceremonial which held sway in the heyday of the Holy Roman Empire. This set the style for the several hundred principalities which made up Germany until its unification. And on the day of the funeral of Karl August, the guest list has eerie echoes of those courts of vanished splendor. The mourners include 4 grand dukes, 4 ordinary dukes, 51 princes, and 34 princesses. They are here for a private ceremony, whose official status is no different from any other in the modern Republic of Germany. But somehow, when a prince of Thurn and Taxis dies, his passing takes on all the aura of a state occasion. Funerals rank with marriages as milestones in the progress of an aristocratic dynasty. And of the 2 occasions, joyful and sad, it is Prince Johannes' opinion that marriages are greatly overrated.
You will find that at a funeral, you meet all the interesting people, you've had something to do with your family, and at the average funeral, you meet every nice relative you've known, you meet the old people you have not seen for a long time. At a marriage, you meet usually new people. The funeral, at least, is a finished picture of a person, which the wedding is not. At a funeral, you can contemplate about the person who has died and how much success the person had. So if it's a successful life, it will be a beautiful funeral.
The passing of a prince marks the end of an era, but it also celebrates one more generation of accomplished family endeavor. And for the Thurn of Taxis, that endeavor stretches back more than 500 years. Years is not very long by the standards of German nobility, and the founder of the Thurn and Taxis fortunes was not a conventional nobleman. Franz von Taxis was a postman, and when he had his portrait painted in 1514, he made sure the world took note of how he made his money. Letters were the business of the family, who were then known simply as von Taxis. Their couriers were the Pony Express of Western Europe, carrying letters between the inns and stables that were their staging posts. There's a legend that the word taxi comes from the stagecoaches with which the Taxis family transported letters and people around Europe for nearly 400 years. Thank you. postal network was a multinational business, which ended only in the 19th century, making the Thurn and Taxis one of the richest families in Germany. And they decked themselves with all the trappings appropriate to a dynasty that had been built up across the generations. The latest prince to be laid to rest in the family vault below the palace was a man of principle. In the 1930s, Karl August von Thurn und Taxis was an opponent of the Nazi party, and he forbade his only son Johannes from becoming a member of the Hitler Youth.
It was a very unusual thing. There was hardly any German boy, and not even in aristocratic circles, who was not in the Hitler Youth. So I had to get forward, step forward, and say, I don't join them. And of course, I must say, there were moments when they beat me up. And then when I drove home on my bicycle, or pushed my bicycle home in winter due to snowfall, and I was beaten up and had a blue eye and something, my father would say to me, Saint Sebastian died as a martyr. Why don't you try to sacrifice all these things up to the higher honor of our Lord? Which, of course, was for a boy a bit complicated to do. At times, when I remember my childhood, I was always fascinated that some people could live in houses where we had to live in palaces or castles. I always had the feeling that living in a palace is like living in a hotel. I thought it's much more interesting and much more fascinating to live in a small house.
Schloss Regensburg contains more than 500 rooms, and that makes it larger than Buckingham Palace. In the 18th century, the Thurn und Taxis were sent to Regensburg as representatives of the Holy Roman Emperor, and they set themselves up in imperial style. Today, their palace is one of the last of Europe's great noble residences that is still lived in exclusively as a private family home. And the children of Prince Johannes and Princess Gloria have yet to discover that every little German girl does not grow up with this sort of playground.
When you live in such a place like here, then more than somewhere else, it is good to have the instinct to stay down to earth and to know that, for example, my daughters, they are not going to live in a palace like this all their lives. That is for sure. Because their brother, the oldest one, will live here. But the rest of the family has to be prepared slowly, slowly, that their life is not going to be like this. I mean, my daughters have to learn later on. I want to send them to schools where they learn sewing, where they learn cooking, and everything like this, because later in life, they will be happy if they can do that.
So you're counting on having a son?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I want to have 10 children. I'm sure that there will be one son under them.
The 11th prince of Thurn und Taxis took his time before knuckling down to his matrimonial duties. Prince Johannes was 54 years old when he married the Countess Gloria von Schönberg-Glaukau in 1980. And so far, the couple have had two daughters. Their latest, the Princess Elizabeth, is 5 months old. Their first child, the Princess Maria Theresia, is 18 months. Both little girls have been given Christian names that are traditional in the family, like their father. And his name goes back more than 15 generations. The present Prince Johannes bears a singular resemblance to a forefather who ran the family postal service in the 16th century. But this early Johannes was far from princely. Europe's postmen were known simply as the Texas family. And though they had noble pretensions, they were looked down on by Germany's traditional aristocrats because they lacked a really ancient pedigree. So in the 1640s, the Countess Alexandrine von Texas set about finding one. She commissioned a family tree to demonstrate a connection between the von Texas and an ancient clan of Italian aristocrats, the noble house of Torriani, or della Torre. Torre means tower, and the German for tower is Turm. So Alexandrine added a tower to the family coat of arms, and she decorated the family name as well. The plain von Texas family became von Turm and Texas. Fighting battles is a proper occupation for an aristocrat. Being a postman is not. So by establishing a link with a family of Italian warrior princes, the Turn and Taxis were laying claim to the status they had previously lacked. They then adorned their palace walls with specially commissioned tapestries to persuade the world that they did not start off in life delivering letters. And they evidently succeeded. For in 1695, Eugene Alexander von Turn and Taxis was raised to the dignity of Prince of the Holy Roman Empire. It had taken 2 centuries, but the postmen had become princes. A double-barreled name is a sure sign that someone, somewhere in the family history, was making an effort to impress. But nowadays, the Turn and Taxis find that creating the right impression is something that comes naturally. The christening of the baby Princess Elizabeth is presided over by Prince Johannes's uncle, Father Emmeram, a monk of the Dominican order. And the baby's godparents are Duke Max in Bavaria and the Countess Elizabeth von Oppersdorf.
Mit großer Freude nimmt ich die christliche Kirche auf. In ihrem Namen bezeichne ich die...
By the standards of Schloss Regensburg, it's quite a homely ceremony, with the christening taking place in the smallest of the family chapels, because the little Elizabeth is a girl. Turn and Taxis babies must be male to rate a christening in the main chapel. The family tree of the new baby shows her parents to be related. Prince Johannes and his wife are distant cousins as a result of the interbreeding encouraged by the strict marriage laws of the German nobility. For one anxiety of the aristocrat is not to slip down the ladder ascended with such care by previous generations. And the call of family duty can be strong. Prince Johannes wasn't always a model of the domestic virtues, for until recently, he was less known for his appearances in church ceremonies than in nightclubs and at cocktail parties. He had a wide and unconventional circle of friends in German cafe society, and gossip columnists linked his name with a succession of glamorous escorts. So when he did finally marry in May 1980, his wedding took on something of the character of a fairy tale. Maintaining an historic lifestyle at the end of the 20th century costs money, and one entire wing of Schloss Regensburg is dedicated to the commercial enterprises of Prince Johannes. He walks to work there every day, down the corridor. He's inherited all his forefathers' flair for making money. When the family postal business ended in the last century, the Turn and Taxis diversified, and today there's a varied portfolio of interests to be supervised from the private office inside the palace. Being a playboy hasn't stopped Prince Johannes building up a formidable business empire from his castle in the heart of Regensburg. Regensburg itself is an ancient medieval city on the banks of the Danube, and the Turn and Taxis family own a great deal of it. If you're a citizen of Regensburg, the prince will look after your money for you. He provides merchant banking facilities for private investors. And he uses his bank to service a conglomerate of international enterprises currently valued at over £100 million. His interests include an electronics factory near Stuttgart, an advertising agency, property developments in Brazil and the United States, farms and forests all over Germany, and one of the largest breweries in Bavaria. Quite apart from being a prince, Johannes von Thurn und Taxis is a self-made millionaire. His relatives sensed his business ability when he was a young man. They put him in charge of the family assets soon after the Second World War. And today, the wealth of the Thurn und Taxis derives largely from his own commercial talents. Princess Gloria was a student when she met her husband, working to pay her own way through drama school, since her family, though titled, were impoverished. And she has yet to surrender completely to the tempo of life in a palace.
I ride the motorbike because I love it. I did it already, I started it with 15 years, I did motocross, and which is quite a dirty sport. But there you learn how to ride the motorbike. And of course now I love to do it still because it's nearly the only way that I can get away without anybody knowing me with my helmet on. Nobody knows me. And I can go wherever I want, and then I like the wind. It's like flying. Only flying is nicer.
There's been a brewery in the family for more than 80 years, but it's Prince Johannes who has made it a real money spinner with a series of takeover bids that have swallowed up 29 of his local competitors. Production at the Thurn und Taxis brewery now stands at 10 million gallons a year.
In my opinion, it's motivating if the people are working for you have constant access to you, or at least the possibility, if they have some problems, that they can talk about their problems, and that one tries to resolve whatever problems they have. And besides that, I think it's very interesting and important for people to know for whom they're working.
Prince Johannes has nearly 2,000 employees on his payroll. Even in the current recession, his business has kept expanding. And when he talks about his challenges, he's not so much the aristocrat as a good, old-fashioned tycoon.
It's a very, very thrilling thing to live in a competitive world.
You don't think you've got lots of advantages in a competitive world?
I don't think one does have advantages nowadays. If one carries a name, a historical name, people are rather ready to criticize you than giving you merit for it.
So you think your title's a drawback?
I wouldn't really say drawback, but if you find a man in an important position, director, president, whatever, and you walk in and you see, God, is this man important? Then you talk to him, and you all of a sudden realize he's just a little man like you and I.
You see yourself as just a little man?
Just a little man like it. But then, of course, I feel that we have compete on bases which have nothing to do with families or nobility.
When you want your night to sparkle, make sure you have the right sparkle. Bolla Brut. As wine critic Lawrence Eisenberg said in Gentleman's Quarterly magazine,
a recent sampling of 23 sparkling wines revealed that all are good, some are spectacular. The best of the lot, Bolla Brut, is very light and wonderfully dry.
When you want your night to sparkle, Bolla Brut, it outsparkles all the rest. At 3M, one idea leads to another. This spill, this oil spill, is a problem these absorbent 3M fibers solve. Then, 3M scientists turn the fibers' insulating properties into a different idea. Thinsulate thermal insulation. And winter wear got slimmer and warmer. Sharing technologies helps one idea lead to another at 3M.
You know, KLM's new improved business class is remarkably,
spacious.
Exactly. And with all this space for your legs, it's so very,
comfortable.
Exactly. And this seat is so much,
wider?
Yeah. I suppose that's why they call it...
new.
Yeah.
KLM's new business class. All that space makes all the difference.
When a businessman is waking up in, say, Los Angeles, his main office in New York is already well into its day. And very often there's information the main office would like men such as this to have the moment they come in. Well, now, through a modern computer innovation called telemail, they can send them that information and have them punch it right up the minute they arrive.
Gee.
No, GTE.
Gemma is 30.
I know I'm 30.
She seeks the simple things in life.
I want the phone to ring and God to be on the other end.
Has she found the perfect man?
Marry me.
What for?
Or maybe the perfect solution?
Who are you, anyway?
She'd never go solo.
No more men. No more tears.
Or would she?
Begin Sunday on the Arts and Entertainment Network.
The Thurn and Taxis family today own 11 castles in Bavaria, and 6 of them are still lived in. They lost some of their estates when the Red Army occupied Prussia and Eastern Europe at the end of the Second World War, but they are still the largest landowners in the Federal Republic of Germany. West Germany is an affluent society. But few of its citizens enjoy affluence on the scale of the Thurn and Taxis. And that can cause problems in a country whose recent social reformers have included the Baader-Meinhof gang. Prince Johannes and his wife lead a high-profile lifestyle which makes them very obvious targets.
Nowadays, terrorism supplies things which you cannot really fight against unless you really have either a private army or at least, you know, 2 or 3 people around you with guns.
Do you carry a gun yourself?
I usually do. In Germany, I usually do, yes.
One of the problems with owning 11 castles is finding time to visit them all. But Prince Johannes does manage to spend a few weeks every year at his summer castle. It stands on family land at Dischingen, near the western border of Bavaria, and it's called Schloss Taxis. Time was when supper was prepared and laid every evening in all the castles of the Thurn and Taxis, on the off chance that the prince might turn up unexpectedly. The family retainers were numbered in hundreds, but Prince Johannes has made economies. He's cut his staff down to 50, and when he travels to his holiday castle, the footmen are sent on ahead from Regensburg. As a descendant of the princes of the Holy Roman Empire, Johannes von Thurn und Taxis does not rank as a royal prince. And in the German pecking order of such weighty matters, he he actually ranks lower than dukes and grand dukes. So when he has friends round for the evening, getting the table plan right is as important as choosing the menu. Guests of the Thurn and Taxis are always seated in strictest order of precedence.
Nein. Und Willi, wenn Sie mir dann noch einmal jetzt gerne unterschriften.
Jawohl.
The only non-German members of the household are the nannies, one each for Princess Elizabeth and Princess Maria Theresia, since their mother decided in the best tradition of European aristocracy that the nannies had to be British.
I chose a Scottish girl first of all because I wanted to learn English better. And the second thought was that my children could grow up with two languages. And I feel that the only real gift you can give to your children is to make them learn languages. So without money, but knowing a lot of languages, you're always a rich person. Myself, I don't feel rich. Although we move from one castle to the other, we are not living like very rich persons. We never speak about money. We never go to the most expensive tailors. We go shopping where it's cheap. And we don't fly around with jets. My husband is very modest with himself.
Modesty is relative, and so is formality. Thurn and Taxis family etiquette grades social gatherings as full gala, half gala, or informal. And this evening's dinner party is an informal occasion. Prince Johannes always likes to mark his arrival in the country with a party. And first to turn up are a handful of guests from the castle next door. They're not locals. They're people like him. Aristocrats, plutocrats. Glossy with that veneer whose hallmarks are leisure and money. It's early June, but already they've acquired their Riviera suntans.
Hello. How was the lunch?
Was
very
nice.
Was it?
But, it's a bit strange because it looks too elegant inside.
Quando tutti sposi col giudeo, devi sapere.
Io ho una faccia oggi così con le pieghe. Oggi ieri
con le pieghe.
Life lived inside the confines of a rigid social pecking order is a very comforting experience, if you're at the top. But it's not without its problems. The arrival of an unexpected baron can wreak havoc with the seating plan. This dinner party is to celebrate Prince Johannes's 56th birthday. And one of the guests has brought along his huntsman to offer the prince a most unusual present.
Oh.
It's the world premiere of a hunting call composed especially in the honor of Prince Johannes von Thurn und Taxis.
Thank you.
This birthday makes the prince 34 years older than his wife. And most of his friends date from before his marriage, when he spearheaded the German division of the international jet set.
The whole court liked me, and they said to me before I married my husband, we all pray that you're going to marry the prince and you're going to have many children, and we help you whenever you need help, and in a, such a surrounding you don't have to worry, the people tell you what you have to do. I go to the kitchen and say it was beautiful, the dinner, thank you. And I speak, I ask how is your wife and how is the children. That is the difference. In former times, nobody used to go out in the kitchen and speak. It was not necessary then. Nowadays, they are very happy if you go out. If I wouldn't go out and say the food was good, after a while, my cook would think, well, don't I cook good enough now? Or what happens? Princess doesn't come to me anymore.
Hear something funny? An Evening at the Improv. Now that's funny. An hour of the funniest comedy on television. An Evening at the Improv on this station every week.
Not by a strange rain, but by a
fireworks.
This was one of the last big
parties end sedately in Schloss Taxis these days. Marriage, it seems, can subdue even a playboy prince.
I remember the Rothschild giving this.
I've quieted him down a lot. Before he met me, he was really just like a blitz around. I mean, in Germany, he's only known as the party and social person who is everywhere, and the young people have known him from all over, from the beer garden, from the discos. And in fact, if I go to Munich, I often am very astonished how many young people he knows and are his friends.
I've noticed you call him Goldie. What does that mean?
I call him Goldie because it sounds so Jewish. First of all. And then I call him Goldie because I like him to wear a gold bracelet here and a gold chain there, and that looks so rich. this is why.
You think he's rather healthy to make fun of him a little bit?
Yes, very healthy. It's very healthy.
Once every summer, Prince Johannes likes to inspect his farms. And when he does so, he takes the care he always does to dress in a costume appropriate to the occasion.
Schau, die macht jetzt gleich Kaka.
Kauft man so mit 80 Kilo und verkaufen die Tiere mit 600 Kilo.
Ja.
Sie hat Hunger. Komm her, Muku.
Kriegst du was zu essen? Ja.
The cow.
Yes, Lacey.
I think.
Oh. A black. Ah. Ah, you're to be fun.
The modern wealth of the Thurn in Texas comes largely from business. But Prince Johannes never forgets that the bedrock of aristocratic staying power has always been the land.
We lost a lot of our land in the Second World War, and we tried to reinvest in land, because we always learned all through the years, 1,000 years of history, that if you keep two-thirds of your wealth in land, you're not as exposed to changes in economic life.
Ja, das ist natürlich nicht filmreich.
Böse, hat ein Aua, ja. Da war in der Sonne und hat sich nicht zugedeckt, der böse Papa.
The big machines are coming down.
Bist du stolz auf sie?
Davon, the big
machines. Goldie, bist du stolz auf sie?
Look at the big machines.
Hallo, Maschinen! Oh!
Prince Johannes exploits his farms as efficiently as his other business enterprises. But though the machines are modern, the drivers salute their master with a deference that is truly traditional.
It is not really a demonstration of being a servant or something. It's just they are very close to my family. And nowadays we share so many positive and negative experiences that it's a mutual affection. Part of what we say about aristocracy is keeping up old customs and habits. Modern times have been so quick putting away old good habits and customs, and we are deprived of so many things that even now we see it with the churches. So many churches have done away with all the worldly charm of them. And those young people, they have to go to Pune in India to find the mysticism and the old habits which our churches had before.
So you think aristocracy plays a useful role?
A useful role in conserving the habits which have been good enough for 300 or 400 or 500 or 700 years.
Grüß Gott.
Grüß Gott.
Grüß Gott. Grüß Gott. Grüß Gott. Wie geht's?
Grüß Gott. Danke.
Geht's gut?
Danke.
Good morning.
How are you today?
I'm very happy that you married.
When Germany was a patchwork of little principalities run by noblemen like Prince Johannes, every aristocrat had his own corps of huntsmen. They had their own uniforms and their own code of horn signals with which they would marshal the hunts that were the high points of the winter social season. But today, Prince Johannes is one of the few aristocrats who can still afford to hunt in that style. Years ago, the princes of Thurn in Texas bequeathed their hunting lodge in the forests around Regensburg to a memorial of the type beloved by the Germans in the age of unification. It was called Valhalla, and it was intended to symbolize the ideal of the best, the Greek word for the best being Aristos, from which the word aristocracy is derived.
I can recognize mostly an aristocrat if I see him in the street because they all look alike.
How do they look?
Well, they have those noses. They have big noses. And they are all dressed alike.
You don't have a big nose, though.
Yes, I'm an exception. But my father and my mother, they have all those noses.
Does your husband have a big nose?
Yes, I think he has also. Or if you look at the picture, he has also this typical nose that the aristocrats run around with. Then they dress in the same way. Then they have the same interests. And
what interest is it that they have?
Mostly hunting. I hardly know any aristocrat that doesn't go shooting, because most of them own forestry. So if you put it together all in all, you can find that nearly all the aristocrats have something in common.
Aristocrats travel from every country in Europe to hunt with the Thurn and Taxus. Guests of honor at this boar hunt are the prince and princess of Liechtenstein. Hunting is more than just a pastime for the aristocrat, for it goes back to the very origins of his class, to the Dark Ages, when the nobleman was leader of the pack. In time of war, he led his community into battle. In time of peace, he demonstrated his power by going into the forests to vanquish the wild beasts that lurked there. And in the forests of Bavaria, the fiercest of those beasts was the wild boar. Sport over, the heroes of the hunt join their ladies at a guest house nearby. The comfortably padded existence of the modern aristocrat is a reminder of just how unfair life can be. For if the world were a perfect place, then we would all be equal. But it is not. And aristocrats are a class who've developed the preservation of inequality to a fine art, making a full-time profession of that ancient human impulse to set aside a little something to hand on to the children. Prince Johannes uses his inheritance to keep the 20th century at bay. He may employ modern tractors to lay out the bodies of the 75 boars which he and his guests have shot today, but the disemboweled carcasses are paraded for a ritual which, like the hunt itself, goes back into the mists of history.
And last time we had 235 kilos.
The victorious hunters deck their hats with pine fronds, which have been dipped in the blood of the animals they have shot. Tradition has it that they will gain strength from the blood of the enemies vanquished in this fair and equal contest.
And in any case, you see the thing you get to receive.
Yes.
No one can tell if the vanquished boar considered it a fair fight. But the ancient rituals of aristocracy are not really much concerned with fairness. They are to do with having and holding and inheriting and keeping. And in the last analysis, all the style and grace of the nobleman boil down to embellishments of that. Aristocrats nowadays like to say that they are an endangered species, but somehow they still manage to survive. In the summer of 1983, Prince Johannes and Princess Gloria were blessed by the arrival of a baby son, Prince Albert Maria Lamoral Miguel Johannes Gabriel. So Princess Gloria did not have to have 10 children after all, to ensure there should be at least one more prince of Thurn and Taxis.
Aristocrats by Robert Lacey is published by Little Brown, available at local bookstores now.